Another year's gone by. I'm so glad you're with me.
Welcome to Orange is the New Black podcast, season 2, episode 1, Thirsty Bird.
Thirsty Bird.
Your hosts today are Martha Southgate,
Rob Southgate,
Megan Haas.
Megan, this is our first time for the three of us talking and podcasting together. This is really exciting. Before we get into it, before we go into the description of this and get into this conversation, which we've already been doing for 20 minutes without the mic being on, I just can't wait to get into it. I want to introduce you a little bit more. We know Megan because of a partnership we have with showratings.tv, which is this awesome website where they review and rate TV shows. You as a listener or as a user can go in there and you can rate shows yourself, and it's just really awesome. And please, we encourage you to join Show Ratings TV and read Megan's reviews and read everybody's reviews on there. It's just a great group, and we have a partnership with them. We're actually working with them, and it's been wonderful. Everybody we've worked with has been just fabulous. So that's who Megan is.
Yes.
What else do you want to tell us about yourself, Megan?
I work with Show Ratings. I review a handful of shows, Orange is the New Black being one of them. I'm very excited to be reviewing that this year because it was one of my all-time favorite shows. I'm studying TV and reviewing TV. And
cool. What other shows are you reviewing?
I review The Fosters on ABC Family, Bates Motel on AMC.
I love Bates.
Oh, we wanted to do a podcast for that because we love that show.
It's such a headache to review because it's so heavy, but it's really fun.
It's kind of like The Killing. We do a killing podcast, and it's like, oh my gosh, it's not lighthearted.
Some of those episodes, you're just like, oh please, I can't even. I don't want to watch it, let alone talk about it again.
And I like review my shows. I have to write on paper while I'm reviewing. I can't use the computer, and it's just pages upon pages, and at the very end, it doesn't even matter. I'm like, oh
yeah,
my goodness.
That's how we do it, too.
That's how we take our notes.
So what other shows do you do?
The Fosters, Bates Motel, Downton Abbey, and Orange is the New Black.
Oh, awesome.
So all very light shows. I'm kidding. That's awesome. That is awesome. And you've also been on our network before. For people that don't know, we have a show called, that's actually a Show Ratings TV show. It's Show Rating TV Roundtable, Pilot Roundtable.
Yes.
And you've been on that too.
Yes, I have. I just recently discussed Crossbones, and Kyle's going to kill me because I forgot what I discussed first.
You know what? I forgot too, so don't worry about it. And I edited it. So, you know what? One last thing.
Oh, come on. I'm dying to talk about the show. All right, go ahead.
I discussed Penny Dreadful.
Oh,
yes,
there you
did.
Go.
Okay. That's right. I just wanted to touch on that really quickly. I loved that Penny Dreadful, and I have not gotten further in, but I am dying to.
See, the only thing with Penny Dreadful, some people are hating it, and it's okay. I understand why. I'm only in it because, I really like Eva Green. I feel like she's so talented, and
she's great on it.
She's going to further her popularity, her much-needed popularity through this. But I had a theory, and I've had this theory since episode 1, I think, that that Vanessa, that's her name, is in a relationship with Mina, and it's just becoming true, and I feel like I'm a genius from it, so I'm only watching it to further my own, like...
I love those. Like, I love those moments.
Well, they said... Vanessa discussed something with somebody and said secret poetry, and I'm like, what else is secret in Victorian? She's gay! And like... Nobody believed me, and Kyle was making fun of me, and now I think I'm right, and I think next episode's going to prove it, and I'm not going to let anybody forget about it.
I love it. I did that with The Killing, and one of our listeners wrote and said, I can't believe Martha picked up from the beginning.
Yes.
That's, you know, and I was like, oh, I did.
I did that.
Very proud of herself.
I had a brain cell function.
I have, like, little moments like that, and I remember in... American Horror Story season 2. I had that. I was like, you know what, Doctor, what's his face? He's the killer. And everybody's like, no, no, no. And then it was. They're like, how did you know? I'm like, I'm a genius. Like, nobody gets it. So I'm just like, I'm waiting for Sunday's episode to air and have that be true. And I'm just going to be terrible to deal with.
Well, nice. I predict that Big Boo likes girls. So we're going to find out that I'm a genius.
There you go.
Right. Very perceptive.
You all couldn't tell at all.
So, Megan, can you start us out by giving a synopsis of the show?
So Piper's world is turned upside down when she's forced to realize that she did, in fact, beat Pennsylvania to a pulp and is now in Chicago for a hearing of the drug lord that her and Alex worked for. And she realizes that Alex is also at this prison and that she's facing a trial more than her previous actions back at prison.
Yeah, right.
Okay. I loved this episode, even though it had me on edge through most of it, because I was sitting there the whole time feeling what she was feeling, going, why don't they tell her anything? Where's she going? What's happening? And I just have to say, okay, when they landed in Chicago, Rob and I have just, like, within the last week had a conversation with people about the prison in the middle of downtown Chicago.
Right. And they had no idea it was there. And we're like, you can tell by the windows, this is where it is. We actually know somebody that had been a guest there, we shall say. And it's so funny because we had been just talking about it. And then when they're driving in, we're like, oh my gosh, they're going to show
that
prison.
They're going to that prison. So that was really kind of fun for us. But
I'm not sure if you've read the memoir, but I read it. I went into this huge Orange is the New Black obsession after season one.
Oh, we did not read it.
It's good. It's a memoir, so I can't really say, like, you should have added this.
Right.
You need more character development.
You need more of this, and it's, like, literally her life. And in there, she does go to Chicago, so...
Oh, really? Now, that was a question I had. So you've read the memoir.
Yes, yeah, I have.
Are we following it at this point?
I've read some interviews where they want to follow it, but they don't want to limit themselves. In the memoir, that prison is where Piper and Alex meet. Quotations. Her real name is not Alex, but she's in prison and she gets flown. I don't know if they told her. I think they might have told her. She gets flown to Chicago for this trial where she does end up telling the truth, if I'm recalling right. I haven't read it for like a year, and she ends up telling the truth. And in there, she finds that she's seated near Alex on the plane, and they get there and she's sharing a bunk with Alex and Alex's sister, who she
had. Oh my gosh.
And like, at first she was like, oh, I hate this girl. I'm gonna, like, same way Piper was in the beginning. But then she realizes that she's in prison for something she's consciously done, kind of like she did in season one. And her and Alex don't have any romantic relationship. They really just have, they decide, I think Piper in the book described that they decide early on that they can't fight. They're in this cell together, like much like the cell in this episode, and that they can't fight because they're in such close quarters, they'll go insane.
Right. So it's a different environment. You have to just put things aside to function.
But she said after she's there for like 2 weeks, I think, I could be wrong, but it's a short stay. They go and they go to the trial. They have no conversation. I think they do, but it's not huge. And then she goes back to prison and finishes out her...
Right, and Alex is only in it for those couple of weeks,
no,
right?
No, she's released. At the end of it, she's released in Chicago and Larry picks her up.
Oh,
really?
Yeah. Well, that does not happen in the
show. So this is where we're breaking free, I have a feeling.
Oh, no.
Well, we've broken free long ago because they had already been in Litchfield.
They have some moments in the memoir that will carry through the season, but they're not going in time order, obviously.
Right.
They're just showing, like, if you read the memoir, you're going to recognize this, but they're putting their own spin on it.
Okay.
Yeah, I've heard that if you're a fan of the show and you're looking for the show, the memoir is not for you.
If you like reading memoirs, if you want to like learn more about this person's story, then
and to me that sounds excellent.
I would love to
get into that.
It's interesting, however, like one of the main things for me for the show is I love Alex and Piper. I love them together. Mm-hmm. But if you're looking for that, that's not the memoir. Alex is in it for like the very end, and it's more about how this woman with this background has come to be in prison. And then, like, the negative critiques of it could be like, oh, she's marketing her experience. She was only in prison for, like, 10 months or 12 months. There's two sides to it. I enjoyed it as, like, I mean, as heavy as the topic is, it's like a good beach read, kind of. Like,
right. Just well, reading you know it. What? I don't care if it was 10 months. That's 10 months more than I spent in prison.
Yes.
Hopefully.
So
yeah.
That's interesting.
You don't have any plans.
And she does.
Right?
I mean, she's definitely got characters she's drawing from. So
yeah, she says in it that she doesn't know, but like there's only two people in the memoir that she has named and used their names exactly because she contacted them and they said yes. But the rest, she said some people hated it. Some people don't like it. Actually, they just released an article on Vogue or Vanity Fair, I think it was Vanity Fair, with the real Alex, and she said she's watching it because it's a great show. It's a great thing to watch, but like she says, it's so fictional that it's. She said,
yeah. Anyone that thinks it's her, they're getting a completely wrong impression, right?
Yeah, and she's like, she kind of counteracted some things the real Piper has said. She kind of pulled them back, but like she's saying, she's going to continue to watch it simply because she said it's a weird relationship that she can't stop watching because it's so good.
Right.
It's not true.
Yeah. Well, the show itself, though, the characters are so
yes
well developed, yeah. and they are to me, it's like every single one is
you want to know
fleshed
the story.
Out. You yeah. just you learn their story over time, each
well,
one,
is,
and
this
you...
is something that I noticed on this episode. Now, this episode in particular, I know that because I've been reading some of the reviews online and kind of seeing what people are saying. I mean, it just hit today, so you know.
Yes. Some people have already finished the season. I don't know.
Yes.
I don't know if they have some special. I don't know. Like how much?
As William Shatner said, "Get a life."
Get
that's
a
lot to cram
shower.
In a day. Yeah. But one of the things I've seen is people complain that in the first episode you're introduced to all these new characters and they want to see the ones they love. I actually had kind of a different reaction because I know we're going to see the ones we love, mm-hmm. but man. I wanted to know about all these new characters. They were so interesting.
Yeah, I mean, I enjoyed it, but like I kind of was talking to people earlier. If you don't like Piper, you're going to be like, all right, when is your story done?
Right.
So don't
mind her.
I mean, personally, yeah. I enjoyed it. I like seeing the contrast between what prison life could be like for her. Mm-hmm. I mean, it's prison, so you can't really get the lucky side of it, but she is kind of getting the lucky side of prison.
Yes.
She is. Well, our friend that was a guest down at that Chicago location, he at one point had, and he said it was very cushy when he was there, he at one point had to go to Joliet, which is a big prison, which is, you want to talk about a contrast?
It's frightening.
Yeah.
Frightening. And he said he was terrified. He was there for 2 weeks, and it was hell on earth. And watching her at this and going to Chicago, I thought, they're showing that this is more the big show and everything, but man, this still isn't.
Mm-hmm.
That
yeah.
you know, she
they're
hasn't entered ours yet.
Yeah,
you know,
they're still worse. But it was scary. That was very scary. But okay, let's talk about some of the lighter. Okay.
Yeah, yeah.
I died when she was on talking when she was talking to the woman and she had to pee when she was on the bus, and she said, the woman says, "Well, didn't you wear the pee pad?"
The pee pad.
I have never laughed so hard when she said, "You just let out a little at a time." On the I cannot tell you how hard I laughed.
Right, and she called it the maxi, and she started going into that whole description of somewhere it this way, and I just like to do this. I'm like, oh my god.
And then
gosh.
She says, "Oh, I'm doing it right now," and she's making that horrible face. I'm like, no.
That's the part. That's the when she said it, I was like, okay, we're back into this comedy. Like, I love how the show yeah. balances out.
Yes.
Yes.
Comedy. Because if it was just Piper dealing with this prison, I would have been like, oh my goodness, I either need to cry or turn this off or something. So it's like,
oh my gosh, when she was in the shoe,
yeah.
and she had painted the thing on the wall with
the egg.
The thirsty bird.
Yeah.
That was awful to watch because I just felt like she was broken down and they weren't giving us a break on it.
Yeah.
And then when she just wanted to know what was happening and they wouldn't tell her, it was like,
but
oh.
even there, the guy had funny lines, you know, like.
He did.
Yeah,
I found
she
it
said,
to be hard to get through that.
Oh, it's a yellow warbler eating out of a daffodil. It's art, you know, and I thought, okay, that's good. Like old Piper, you know. But then he says it smells like old Easter in here.
Yeah.
I thought this one just had the best quotes, like the whole, all my notes.
Yeah,
we were
writing a lot of quotes.
I was just writing
on this
quotes
one.
Down.
Even when she's on the bus, she's crying and these four people are like cracking jokes.
Right.
Right. So
just, I was sitting there. I was like, this is perfect. This is like exactly what this show is about.
Yes, yeah. I agree.
Well, and when you heard the guards talking and the guy's like, he said something about her being a poochie. He's
Whoa,
like, yeah,
that was so
we
funny.
Can't call them bitches anymore.
like, that's less derogatory.
Right.
Well, I wanted to be like, yeah, because calling them bitch is the worst thing you could possibly do. Like,
right,
everything you've done, that's the thing you've changed.
Right.
Well, exactly. And then Piper had the great line. This was beautifully orchestrated because they had that little line with the guard, which was funny.
Yeah.
And of course you remember it because it was so funny how he said it. But then she goes, "I can't abide demanding poochies." And that was brilliant.
Yeah.
And that was Piper too. That was edge that she has.
I keep thinking, like, I think the strongest part of this episode and episode two, even though this is for episode one, is the writing. Their writing is so crazy good that it just, they have great actors, and like pretending to be these women who don't really care, they're just,
they're
here is one thing, but then you have this writing that they can bring that up. And even at the end when like, I know we haven't gotten here yet, but when Piper's in the jail and she thinks Alex has gotten out, the little cockroach runs underneath her.
Yeah,
that's, like, that's brilliant. That was a great placement of that, because I'm laughing at this cockroach, even though Alex completely just tore everything up.
Right. Tore her life down. Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Yes.
It's brilliant. Well, you know, that was another thing I wanted to bring up about this particular episode. You know, Jodie Foster directed.
I was just going to say that.
And to me, as somebody who watches a lot of film and is really into that kind of thing, I really felt like we were seeing the hand of a movie director a lot of the time in this.
Well,
that's a compliment.
Like, this is like one long movie, because you don't sit here and it doesn't feel like it is TV, but it's essentially a 13-hour movie, and that's how they described it. And she directed one episode in season one as well. She did Lesbian Request Denied, and she wanted to do it because she was supposedly developing a show on Showtime, I believe, and wanted to kind of feel what this was. And I guess she came back for another one, and she's great. It was a really
She is great. Well, this one, I think she got even more comfortable, because this was
she's
excellent.
She's done a few, and she kind of like knows the ropes now. I think she does another one in the season as well. I could be mistaken. I think I'm wrong.
Cool. Oh, cool. I look forward to it.
Okay. So I loved once she gets on the airplane, that scene was just loaded. I mean, there were so many funny lines in that, and so many.
Oh, yeah. Well, and the woman sitting next to her.
Okay. She looks like, I said to Rob, she looks like Lori Petty. I did the same thing. I go, she looks like the woman from that baseball movie.
This is what Martha says.
And Rob goes, Lori Petty. I go, yeah. And he goes, Lori Petty's in the show. She's yoga. You know, the yoga. I go, no. This one looks more like Lori Petty.
I was sitting there and I was like, because A League of Their Own is the movie. It's one of my all-time favorite movies. And I'm sitting here like, I've heard that voice before. She's a very distinctive way of talking. I was like, I've heard that voice. And I remember reading somewhere that she was going to play a character, but I completely forgot that she was doing it. So I'm watching this. I'm like, it's the girl from A League of Her Own. It's the little sister. It's the little redhead. And I made my friend look it up. And I was like, I knew it. I knew she was in this. I'm kind of disappointed that she was only in a little tiny bit of a scene, but she was great in it. Like,
Wait. Meg, Lori Petty, that wasn't Lori Petty in this one.
Yes, it was.
No, Lori Petty was yoga in the first season. Wasn't that Lori Petty?
No.
I hear typing.
Am I wrong?
Come on.
Who was Yoga Jones?
No, Yoga Jones is that she's from Doug, that kid, the kid show.
I've never seen Doug.
I totally nailed Lori Petty.
So wrong.
No, I mean, she's Lolly, and Yoga Jones is
holy cow.
I win.
That's Lori Petty. Definitely, I can hear her talk.
I totally want.
Wait, did you find it? Did you find it?
Yes, that's.
I love it. I go, this one looks more like Lori Petty.
Let me hand in my genius card here for a second.
Yeah, you're done.
I believe I said at the beginning.
Yeah, Yoga Jones is Constance Shulman.
I totally nailed it.
Yeah, because she's back this season.
But she looks a lot like Lori Petty, and I kept.
But she doesn't talk like her. She has her like.
But she's older too. I thought maybe.
Yeah.
Oh my gosh! I'm dying now. I was right.
Because it's so funny.
He was making so much fun of me, and I go, "Wait a second! Like, this one looks more like Lori Petty." He's like, "I don't care which one."
Everyone can feel free to make fun of me for that.
Oh, that's so funny. So then, when the guard has her, the marshal has her in the bathroom.
Oh.
And he says, "Can you hurry it up a bit?" And she said, "I'm going as fast as I can." He goes, "Really? Because it's sounding a little light."
Brilliant lines in this one.
Oh my god!
I even said to like when she went to the bathroom and she's like, "There's no door." I'm like, at that point, does it matter?
Really? It would have been coming out my eyeballs after 5 hours.
You're on a bus now. You're on a plane now. You're about to get on another bus. Like, it doesn't matter if like five guards are standing there.
I would have gone in a tin can in the aisle.
Well, and it's just like when people are in the hospital and they say, you know, at some point your dignity just goes out. Yeah. I don't care. She's been in prison long enough. She's probably just like, I would think that she'd be just like, whatever.
Even later when they do the group strip search.
Yeah, when they have to grab their ankles.
Yeah, and she raised her hand. I'm like, every woman in this room is doing exactly what you're doing. And I'm guaranteeing you not one of them feels good about it.
Right, so, exactly.
Make it easier. This will go quicker instead of waiting for somebody to come. And then she's like in solitary and she just does it. I'm like, how many times have you been strip searched? Like,
exactly.
Right.
Why right now that you're like, this is so degrading?
I'm embarrassed now. Right. Yeah,
So the guy that she met on the plane, the guy that turns out he's a hitman, I don't know if you guys thought this, but immediately I thought, oh my gosh, she met the male Crazy Eyes.
Right. That's what I thought.
I was expecting a Chocolate Vanilla Swirl song.
Oh, I love Crazy Eyes. Is my favorite character of all time.
Yeah. Crazy Eyes is our favorite. We always talk about her.
I am interested in, I'm trying to remember what episode two is. I'm interested in seeing when you see her backstory.
Oh, I can't wait. Episode two.
I actually can't call her Crazy Eyes anymore.
Oh, Suzanne, huh?
In my reviews, I was typing and I was like, no, she's Suzanne. She has a name.
Well, that was from season one
when we met her parents. Oh my gosh, I loved that episode. And they're like, Suzanne, what are you doing? You know, and I think, remember
she killed you when she said it to Piper when they were having that moment? She goes, why do they call me Crazy Eyes?
Yeah, and I mean,
oh, she makes me cry. I love her so much.
Her backstory, I'm not spoiling anything because that's down the line, but you'll definitely see more of why she is the way she is.
She just touches me in a way that the other characters don't. She has so much depth of character and pain, and there's a sweetness there. There's just a whole lot of, even though she took a crap in her, or peed in her cubicle, whatever it was, peed in her cubicle thing, you know.
Yes.
But I mean, you know, obviously there's another side to her, but there's just a sweetness to her that is very touching to me. But how about when she's talking about her twitch, Piper?
Yes.
And she says, I think I've moved beyond stress into something more disturbing.
I was like, she's like not even bothered by it. She's like, I think I'm a little bit more disturbed than I should be, but whatever, you know.
Yeah, right.
Chill.
That I'm thinking about it, my eye hasn't twitched in a while.
You know what? As long as you're throwing out your favorite line, I want to throw out my favorite line. Because I have been laughing about this all day. She's having the conversation with Alex. They're at the prison. They're talking. They're kind of, it's very much like you said in the memoir. It seemed like they knew that they were in this space together. They had to kind of put it aside. And as they're doing this, the cockroach goes by.
Oh, my gosh.
And she interrupts their conversation to go, it's a Biggie Small.
Yeah.
Well, she said that a Biggie Slow.
So, Biggie Slow.
And
Biggie Small.
Oh, my gosh. But I don't, that wasn't on this one, was it?
Yeah, that's on this one.
Episode two?
No, it's this
one. Oh, okay. But oh my gosh, that was, it's
to me, that
just
was, that line
so
was the big line. Now, did
funny.
You have a line, Meg, that got you, or was it just all of it?
It, like, I don't know, because I have so many conflicting feelings with this episode, because to me, it was so good, but it didn't feel like the show that I, like, really loved. I think I described it as, like, in episode four review, I described it as like returning back to like school after a summer break, and you're different. Everything around you is the same, but something's off, something's different, and it's just because you've grown a little bit.
Yeah.
And I described it like that because this show, it feels the same, but there's something off. So I laughed at all those lines. I thought the cockroach was genius. It was just these stupid, and like even people living with them, like the girl was obsessed with astrology. She had,
oh my gosh. Oh, she was killing me.
Oh, that's Mazal.
Yeah, when she woke up and she was on top of her, I was like, oh my God.
But she licked her. She licked her whole face. I was like, ew.
Yeah, like that would have to be my favorite. Cause
I died. Yeah, that was really funny. And when they're on the airplane and the pilot says, thanks for flying with us today. We know you have a choice in your air travel. Oh, who am I kidding? No, you don't. You're prisoners.
I like when he goes, please enjoy this flight entertainment. It includes staring into space. I was like, it was really good. My favorite moment was Piper and Alex, because I'm such a shameless Piper and Alex fan. I will support them till the end. I hope they just change the memoir and just have them together. But
so you want Larry out of the picture, and you want
I can't stand Larry.
So many people hate Larry. You know what? Larry's wishy-washy, but I think he adds an element.
I mean,
and I like that it's making his dad be part of it, and his dad has great lines.
Yeah, I mean, I understand why Larry needs to be in it from a critic standpoint. I understand why he's there. Right. Just from a fan standpoint, I'm sitting here like, Larry, nobody likes you. What are you doing?
Yeah.
And he no way.
Scenes coming up where I'm just like, Larry, go away. Like, you don't feel like a part of this. And, like, I understand Piper needs somebody, and she kind of just, like, screwed herself over with all of it. So, I mean, I don't know. I'm not a fan of Larry, even though I think his character's funny. I think he's well-written. And she's married to him in real life, so I'm like, Larry needs
Larry.
Yeah.
How did I not know that?
Well, yeah, but once again, it's not really this Larry. I mean, things are different here.
She's married and they have a kid together.
Wait, Piper? Wait, the woman who plays Piper?
No, Piper.
No, or the woman who wrote the book.
No, she's not married to Jason Biggs.
Well, that's what I was wondering. Okay, I thought maybe I missed something.
No.
He's married to an apple pie. Did you know that?
Ew.
He's married to Jenny Mullen, I think.
Who's
She's
that?
Pretty funny on Twitter. She has a book out. They just had a baby.
Oh. Really?
Side note.
Side note.
But, so,
oh, if I was him, I'd have named it Apple Pie.
He named him Sid.
Sid!
Oh, that's
awesome.
A great name. Okay. Yeah. So when she is in the cafeteria and she needs to get to Alex and she sees her buddy from the plane, the guy.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
And
male crazy eyes.
Oh, my gosh. Okay, so she needs a favor, right? And he tells her that he's a predator.
Right.
And she says, well, there's nowhere for you to violently assault me here. I was dying. I'm like, oh, my gosh, that was so funny. But then when the one says, well, he's a hitman, you know, like he's not a predator. He's a hitman. She goes, oh, I thought he was a rapist. I'm so relieved.
I know. I was laughing at that, too.
Now, did you know going into it that Pensatucky was going to be, am I saying her name right?
Yes.
Okay, Pensatucky.
Doggett,
right.
Or whatever.
You know what, I say it wrong all the time, but I wrote the right thing, so we'll go with that. But did you know, either of you, that she was not dead? Because the way that last one ended, when I first saw it, I didn't think she was dead. But when we watched it last night, I thought Piper killed her.
Mm-hmm.
Did you know?
I knew she was alive.
You did, okay.
Because you had the book.
I read a lot of articles and I read a lot of interviews and I was like, it kind of ruins the illusion because you see who signed on, who's a special guest star, and you're like, oh, they can write about this. Yeah, she was signed on. So I was like, oh, she's living.
We don't do any of that. So we just kind of watch and we're very naive because we're literally just in the moment of the show. So we'll be a good balance with you because So like you have total naivete over here and then somebody who's actually knows what's going on.
Oh, I'm that person that I'm like at the end of it, I'm like, I wonder why they did that. Are they gonna bring that in? And I'm like, I completely ruin it for myself. But then it's still entertaining. I still love it. Like, I know did you guys not hear the whole situation with Laura Prepon?
What?
Where she almost wasn't on, or
yeah, that one. I don't know how you could miss that.
Oh, I missed that.
She wasn't going to be on at all, I thought, and then she agreed to 4 episodes.
She had a prior filming commitment, so she's a special guest star this year. This season.
Okay,
but isn't she in more than 4? Didn't she expand it to like 7 or something?
No, she's in 4, I believe.
Okay.
She's full time next season.
Oh, okay.
Oh, full time next season.
So I'm like, how are they going to write that in? So
that's going to be interesting.
So I ruined it for myself. But I knew Pensatucky was going to be alive.
Yeah.
Okay, so my favorite speech of this episode was when Piper was talking to her grandmother after she sees her dad kissing another woman.
Yeah.
And the grandmother said, sometimes it's not a matter of right or wrong. Sometimes it's making a choice that causes the least amount of pain to others, keeping things to yourself, sitting on information and feelings and living with your secrets. And Piper says, that sounds horrible. And she goes, oh, it is.
When she was telling, when she goes in and tells her mom that her dad's cheating on her mother.
Yeah.
I was like, this mom's not going to, like, do anything but ignore it. because right. they're that family that needs to look perfect.
Yes. Right.
Oh man, was she in denial though? That was unbelievable.
So when you heard the speech from her mother, you know, from the grandmother, and you go, she's like, well, of course my daughter would have reacted like that. Would you have expected anything else? And then she gives this speech, and I was like, oh my gosh, they just keep handing it down from generation to generation. Yep. You know, just well, sit and, on and your feelings.
Once again, not to beat a dead horse, but the writing was so good at the very end, after all that we saw with her childhood, these lessons she learned, the whole thing with her dad and the affair. One of the final things she says when she's talking to her dad on the phone is, Dad, I learned everything from you.
Right.
Yeah.
And when she's saying it, what she's meaning is not what it actually meant. And I thought that was brilliant.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. I just liked, was it Piper's flashback? Yeah, Piper's flashback in this one, right? Little
yes.
Piper?
Yep.
Yeah, to her.
Yeah, and I like how the flashback was Piper being afraid to, like, jump out of a bus and go into, like, a movie theater, and then she escalates to, like, being with Alex and being with this drug lord, and then she completely lying on oath, something that I would never imagine Piper doing to protect Alex. It's just such a different character for her.
And you knew Alex was going to screw her over.
Oh, yeah, I knew immediately.
I mean, my gosh, I was like, what is she doing? And but like, oh my gosh, how funny was it?
Piper's going to fall for it every time.
When she was talking to Larry's dad, and she says, well, from what I've seen on The Sopranos.
Yeah. I was like, just like Morello, her entire like view on race is from The West Side Story. I'm like, she's pulling out like her like Sopranos and Law and Order. Like, I know what I'm doing. I was like,
yeah, right.
Oh, I thought that was awesome. Yeah, and when she says to Alex, I only seem to be faced with these extreme moral choices when I'm with you.
Yes.
And, you know, and it's like, yeah, there's a problem here.
But then, I really like that scene. Well, one, because I'm Alex and Piper fan. But I liked it because Piper didn't do what she was supposed to do. Like, she made the choice that, and you saw Alex was terrified. And, like, out of everybody in this group, if he's going to kill someone, it would be Alex.
Because
was so high up on that drug ring. And I loved it when they just showed Alex waiting to testify. Like, you've never seen this character more scared in that moment. And so Piper saw that and was like, you know what, I have to lie. And her story does make sense. I mean, she was really only in it for Alex.
Right.
Like, when they go back, like, it could come back to, like, bite her in the butt. But I don't know if it would, because she did seem like that girlfriend. Like, in the flashback, she walked out of the room to call her dad, and that's when they discussed business.
Right.
So, like, she might not remember it, but she lies for her. And in that moment, you kind of saw, like, she really does care for her. Like, she might like, say, like, oh, I'm just with her because I need comfort in prison. Mm-hmm. No, she really does care for her. And I believe Alex does care for Piper, vice versa. And it's not just, like, oh, they were fun college days and stuff like that.
Well, the interesting thing, when you say, I'm not sure if she'll get in trouble for it, I think she's going to get in trouble for it because Alex said, yes, they've met.
Right.
And she said, no, we've never met. And,
I'm wondering if she said, yes, they met, or if she just went on and said, because she told the truth. I'm wondering if she said that Alex and the drug lord met and that Piper was just there because they were in a relationship.
Right, and that could be,
so you think she may have protected
keeping
her
from going to federal prison too?
Well, Alex didn't hear the testimony either, because so coming from what Alex went into that testimony thinking, all right, Piper just told the truth. If I don't tell the truth, then I'm either going to get extended stay, lying on oath, I'm going to get killed if I get released. So like she's thinking of like I need.
But if she's thinking she's telling the truth, wouldn't she have to say that Piper met this guy?
Yeah, so it's going to be interesting because I have not seen Alex since that episode.
But when they showed her walking up to sit on the stand to take the stand, Alex was right there behind. There's a door right behind the seat, and Alex was sitting there. So wouldn't she have heard her whole testimony?
Well, I'm not sure because from the one law class that I've taken. I think that,
on The Sopranos, they didn't do that.
I mean, last time I watched SVU,
right?
But like, I don't think they would let her hear the testimony, especially if they're both testifying against him.
Okay.
I think if they shut that door, you're in complete silence.
Okay, because that's what all I was thinking was she's hearing this. And she was like 2 feet away, you know. But.
And she said it all happened so fast, I had to tell the truth. I don't think she, I think Alex went up there like.
Just panicked.
I think she was thinking I could tell a bigger lie that like gets Piper out, but gets me out. And then I but you know she's not intending to hurt Piper because, I mean, they all mess up. They all right. their stuff that they've done. But in the van, she said, I can't protect us. Like, I can't protect you anymore.
Right.
So I feel like deep down in these characters, nobody would do something that would end the other person's life.
But in the beginning of season one, Larry's dad did find out that she was the one who threw her under the bus.
Yeah.
So ultimately, she is capable of that and would do that if it served her.
I think she did that because they do explain this in the memoir, and I have two conflicting stories. In the memoir, they said that they hadn't seen each other for how many years. They had no idea where they were, and everybody named everybody.
Okay.
But in the episode, I was kind of viewing it as, you haven't seen this ex in like 10 years.
Right.
And if you name her, you lose a year. So I think she was like scared or something like that. And I mean, if Piper got on the stand, I would have no doubt in my mind that she would also name Alex. Mm-hmm. So I don't really know like how to read it all, but maybe after being with her again in prison and seeing this exchange and stuff like that, maybe she does deeply care for her.
Yeah.
She saw it as it's just prison. Like Piper's not going to get like the death penalty for carrying money.
Right.
Saw it as like she'll get over it if it's going to help me out. And right. she thought they're not going to dig up Piper. Like 10 years with a girlfriend. So I don't know. It'd be interesting to hear why she did it.
Yeah, well, and what's interesting is that, like, for me, I'm basing it purely on what I'm seeing in the TV show.
Yeah.
What the characters are doing in the TV show. And so to hear, well, in the memoir, they did this. And it's like, okay, that fleshes it out a little bit differently.
Yeah.
And makes me, you know, so I think it's going to be good if we read that to, you know.
They're making it as a standalone thing. They're making it as, they're straying so far from it. Like, none of these characters besides Piper, really, are this. And, I mean, they casted her to look just like Piper Kerman on purpose. But they are really straying from it. You can't get 3 seasons now. Season 3 is confirmed. You can't get 3 seasons out of this memoir. So they are straying from it.
Right.
It does kind of like make sense. Like, you just listen to Piper. She's like, how many years have I not seen this woman? Like, she named me and she was mad at it. But like looking back with like a non-judgmental, non-emotional view.
Yeah.
She was like, I'll get 2 years off my like however many stay if I say, yeah, Piper was with me when I did it. Piper did this.
Mm-hmm.
Like, who knows if they would have gone and found Piper, and they did.
Right.
So.
Yeah. Interesting. All right. Well, yeah. I think
that's
I'm
it for this episode. Let's
do you
wrap
have anything more to say, Megan?
No, I thought it was a really good premiere. It was fun to have it back.
Yes.
It's like Orange is the New Black holiday.
Loved it. We woke up this morning. I think we were watching it by 7:30.
I think we were.
I went and got coffee. Then we sat down and watched 5 episodes in a row. But the only negative thing is that it was a daring move to do just Piper in the premiere. It kind of felt like episode 1 and 2 were kind of connected in a way, and they are, but it was daring considering there's 2 camps with this. Like one,
right.
Some people don't like Piper.
Right.
So the only negative thing is the ensemble so strong that they could have done that. But other than that, it was a really good, really good premiere.
And we're going to get to that other ensemble in episode 2.
Oh, so yeah, I can't wait. That's my Tasty episode. Tasty's one of my favorites.
Yes, it is.
I love her.
So let me wrap things up here. You can find this episode and our future episodes as they get posted, and all of our podcasts from Southgate Media Group at our website, which is www.southgatemediagroup.com. You can follow me on Twitter, where I tweet out about this and all of our shows, at rsouthgate. Martha does the tweeting from
SMG Pods.
And Meg, what is your Twitter?
At MEGGH11.
And you can also follow Meg, her writing at showratings.tv. And definitely do that. Definitely follow it and read all the stuff on there. I spend a lot of time reading on that site. It's a blast. And it really gets you engaged with the shows that you love.
And it's fun to see what other people who don't have a platform to publish things.
Right.
It's fun to see what other people are thinking, because you can go on there and rate your own show. And we love to talk to people on Twitter or on our site. We prefer the site, because but we love to hear what other people are thinking about the show, because at the bottom line, we are just fans of TV that like to write about them.
That's right.
Yep.
That's right. And that's what we
and
do.
We like to talk about them.
Jinx.
Nice tagline.
So that's it. Find us on iTunes. Find us on Stitcher. Please rate us and review us. It helps not only us, but it helps other people that are fans of this type of stuff find our shows. So if you like this show, definitely rate it in there, because it is going to help other people find it as well. Thanks for listening, everybody. We will talk to you next time.
All right, bye.
If you would like to donate to help pay for this and other Southgate Media Group podcasts, simply go to our website, southgatemediagroup.com, and click on the donate button. It can be as little as a dollar or, well, as much as you want. Help keep this fun going by supporting this and our other shows. Thanks again for listening, everyone. You're the best fans in the world.